Hey there, I'm Bill and welcome to Project Build, where today we're making these shaker style upper cabinets. The standard height to the bottom of an upper cabinet is 54 inches from the floor and approximately 18 inches from the tops of the counters below. I have 9-foot ceilings in my kitchen, and that leaves me with 54 inches from the bottom of the cabinet to the ceiling, so I designed this cabinet to have a 36 inch tall lower cabinet with a 12 and a half inch tall stacked upper cabinet with frosted glass doors and 5.5 inches above for crown molding. However, I made this as one solid cabinet instead of stacking two smaller ones together, so there wouldn't be a visible seam on this exposed end here. Free plans for these cabinets can be found on my website, which is linked down in the video description. I also included plans for a more standard cabinet like these, and I've stacked a bunch of different size ones together to make a wall of cabinets. All right, let's get to work. I started by breaking down a sheet of 3/4 inch plywood using my circular saw and a clamping straight edge. Then I took that section to the table saw and cut it down into 4 11 7/8 inch panels to be the sides of my upper cabinets. Making them 11 7/8 instead of 12 inches wide allows me to get 4 side panels from a single 4-foot wide sheet of plywood. I also cut out a piece for the bottom of the cabinet. With the sides and the bottom cut for the cabinet box, I need to make a rabbet groove in the back inside edges of the pieces to contain the back panel of the cabinet. I set the fence to 11 7/8, which is the width of the cabinet sides, and I clamped a piece of the back panel material to the fence to offset the cut by the thickness of that back panel material. I set the blade height to about 3/8 inch, which is half the thickness of the 3/4 inch plywood. Then I took the sides and bottom of the cabinet box and I made a pass through the back inside edge of each, moving the fence over slightly after each sequence of cuts until I had made a rabbet groove on the inside edges. I took the bottom piece of the cabinet box to the pocket hole jig, flipping it up never gets old, and drilled 5 evenly spaced pocket holes at each end of the bottom. Next, I edge banded the front edges of each cabinet box piece with 13/16 inch edge banding, heating the edge banding with an iron and running the edge of a wooden block down the edge banding while it was still hot to press the adhesive down into the plywood. And once it had cooled, I trimmed the ends first with scissors and then closely with half of my edge banding trimmer, and then trimmed along the length of the plywood using both sides of the edge banding trimmer. And if you're not familiar with edge banding, I've linked a guide in the video description that I think is a good reference. I'll edge band any and all cabinet box pieces before assembling, as it's much easier to apply the edge banding to individual pieces of plywood. I began assembling the box by placing right angle clamps at the front bottom corners and then put F clamps across the bottom to hold it all in place. Then I screwed the bottom to the sides using pocket hole screws, removing the clamps as I went. I added 3/4 inch thick wood strips at the bottom of the cabinet by spreading wood glue on the back of each strip and tacking them in place with 1 1/4 inch brads. These strips hide the pocket holes and make the bottom of the cabinet look nicer, not that anyone will ever really be looking at that. I marked the height from the bottom of the cabinet to where the lower edge of the shelf that divides the main cabinet from the stacked upper cabinet will be on all 4 corners, and clamped an edge banded piece of plywood with pocket holes at each end in place, the top of that piece in line with my marks, and the back of the piece flush with the front edge of the rabbet groove I cut earlier, and screwed it in place with pocket hole screws. This piece is called a cabinet stretcher and is important as it keeps the cabinet square, supports the shelf above it, and is what we will screw through later to attach the cabinet to the wall. I forgot to add pocket holes here earlier so that I can screw this piece to the shelf above it, so I added a few holes at the top using a portable pocket hole jig. Then I placed my divider shelf, which has 4 pocket holes on the top at each end in place, and screwed it to the sides of the cabinet, and then screwed the cabinet stretcher to that divider shelf. This next part is definitely optional. The divider shelf is going to be up so high that you'd never really see the pocket holes up here, but if just knowing that they exist bothers you like it does me, then you can plug the holes. I did this by putting wood glue in the holes and inserting a 3/8 inch wooden dowel. Then I took a flush cut saw and cut the dowel off. After applying wood filler and sanding later, the holes will be nearly invisible. I added a stretcher across the front of the cabinet that extends 1/4 inch below where the bottom of my crown molding will be, so that the frosted glass doors can overlay the stretcher 1/8 inch, and then there'll be another 1/8 inch gap above that between the top of the door and the crown molding. I also added a small stretcher at the top of the back of the cabinet to further strengthen the box and give another place to anchor the cabinet to the wall. Next, I attached the back panel by adding wood glue to the rabbet grooves and backs of the stretchers, spreading the glue out with a glue brush, laying a sheet of 1/4-inch plywood on the back, and tacking it in place with 5/8-inch brads. I added some 2 1/4 by 1/4-inch thick pine trim to the outside face of the cabinet, first adding the vertical stiles, putting wood glue on the back sides, and tacking them in place with 5/8-inch brads. I made my own trim pieces here from larger boards, but if you don't have the tools to do that, you can buy boards like these pre-made from the store. These larger pieces go all the way from the bottom of the cabinet up to where the bottom of the crown molding will be, as the crown molding will essentially rest on the top of this trim once it's installed. Once the stiles were in place, I added the horizontal rails between them. I used my shelf pin jig to add holes for shelf pins by placing the jig against the back panel and drilling the top hole of the jig first, and then moving it up, continuing to add more holes. And I'll repeat this on the front edge as well as the other side of the cabinet. To prepare the cabinet box for paint, I spread wood filler with a putty knife across all the seams in the trim and between the trim and the plywood box, and filled all the brad nail holes. If you plug the pocket holes in the divider shelf like I did, don't forget to fill those too. Once dry, I used 150 grit sandpaper on my orbital sander to knock down the wood filler and smooth any uneven edges between trim pieces, and then went over all the surfaces to be painted with 220 grit sandpaper to prepare them for paint. I primed everything using a small brush to work primer into the edges of the trim as well as all the inside corners inside of the cabinet box, and then used a foam roller to cover all of the flat surfaces, being careful to leave as smooth of a finish as I could. Priming raises the grain of the wood a bit, so it's a good idea to sand with 320 grit to smooth everything out before adding paint, and the orbital sander is a little aggressive for this, so it's probably best to do it by hand. And after, I painted on 2 coats of semi-gloss white, the same as I did the primer. So typically, you'd make a shaker door using tongue and groove frame that encompasses a 1/4-inch plywood panel, but I'm not doing that here. So I started with a piece of 1/2-inch plywood and then added the same trim I used on the side of the cabinet to make the door visually look the same as a traditional shaker style door. I'm always trying to improve the way I do things, and something I tried here that worked really well was using a brayer roller to spread the wood glue instead of a wood glue brush, and this was way faster. Adding this trim is pretty much the same process as when I put it on the side of the cabinet, adding the stiles first by putting wood glue on the back and tacking them in place with 5/8-inch brads, and then adding the rails in between. I filled all the seams and holes and sanded everything just like before. I applied edge banding to the sides of the doors, trimming it when it was cool, and then the top and bottom edges to give a smooth surface for painting, but I'm not sure that I'd do it that way again in the future, so I discovered a different way of painting plywood edges that I'll cover later in the video. In addition to the standard shaker style doors, I also wanted to make some frosted glass doors to go on the small stack cabinets that are near the ceiling. These doors need to be able to hold a glass panel, which means they have to be designed differently. I decided to use a half lap joint design for this, so I switched to a dado stack on the table saw and then moved the fence over so the edge of the blade lined up with the width of the door material and set the blade height just shallow of half the thickness of the door material. Using an auxiliary fence on my miter gauge, I cut a groove on the ends of 2 scrap boards and then tested out if they would overlap. Now I only needed to cut the ends of the boards to test, I just wasn't thinking it through here. These cuts are still a bit shallow, so I snuck up on the right depth of cut, gradually raising the blade and testing until the boards overlap. Once the blade height was set correctly, I took one of my boards and cut out half the material, and then ran the board back and forth against the fence over the spinning blade to smooth out the rough bottom. Then I'll do a second cutout on the same side of the board at the other end. I know that everyone doesn't have a dado stack, and they're actually illegal in some countries, but you can still make a half lap joint without one, it's just a bit more work. It's mostly the same procedure, setting the blade height about halfway and then moving the fence over until the edge of the door board is in line with the edge of the blade. I had to make a lot more passes here, and you can see it's a pretty rough cutout. So I'll clean this up by moving the board back and forth against the miter fence over the spinning blade like I did with the dado stack, but it's still a bit rough after this. So I further cleaned it up with a chisel and then used a detail sander to smooth it out. And so it's a bit more work, but it's definitely doable without a dado stack. Once all my boards were cut, I laid them out with the front side up. It's important to know that using half lap joints, only one side of the door will visually look like a shaker style door, as the boards that extend the full length on one side are going to look shorter on the other side. So be sure to identify which side of the door is the front and will face out. I added glue to the joints, I brushed it on, and flipped the boards into place. I tacked the doors together with 5/8 inch brads through the back of the door, being sure not to put any brads too close to the inside corners. To allow the door to hold a glass panel, I used a rabbit bit on my router to cut a 1/4 inch groove along the inside of the back of the door and made several passes until there was only 1/4 inch left at the front of the door. The rabbit bit can't get far enough into the inside corners as it has a large radius, and I've used a chisel to square these corners in the past, but I thought of a different way to do this. I clamped a right angle template that I made from some scrap plywood in place, and then used a pattern bit on my router to leave a smaller 3/8 diameter cut on these inside corners, which gives plenty of room for the glass panel to sit on. I made my glass panels from some leftover 1/8 inch polycarbonate I had. I cut the panels out using a metal cutting blade on my jigsaw, making sure the sheet is clamped down and well supported on both sides of the cut. I then rounded the corners with my jigsaw. A quick test fit, and we're good to go. I'm using a frosted film to get the frosted glass look. I unrolled the film, laid the glass on top, and marked the edges. I cut the film out inside of my marked lines, as I want the film to be smaller than the glass panel is attached to. I checked it against the glass and trimmed it in the few places where it was going to be too big and overhang the edge. And once it fit well, I rounded the corners of the film as well. I removed the protective backing from one side of the glass and the frosted film, and then sprayed both liberally with soapy water. I flipped the film over onto the glass and used a squeegee to push the water out from underneath it. The film is adjustable at first, but it adheres more as more of that water is pushed out from underneath of the film. And once it's dry, it looks pretty nice. The doors still need holes for hinges, so I set my concealed hinge jig 3.5 inches in from the end and drilled out the main hinge hole. Then I drilled the two small holes for the screws that hold the hinge on. I added another hole at the far end of the door. My doors are about 36 inches long, so two hinges should be enough support, but once you get to doors over 40 inches, you're likely going to need a third hinge at the middle of the door. All right, it's time to paint all the doors, and after hand painting the cabinets, I decided I don't want to do it that way. So I went and got a sprayer to go with my compressor that I already have, and I'm gonna give this a try. It's my first time using a sprayer, so I'm really curious how it's gonna turn out. Let's go find out. If you're like me and you've never used a paint sprayer before, the first thing I recommend is just filling it with water and spraying it into a bucket. Doing this really helped me understand the different settings of the paint gun and just get a feel for what pressure I needed to use. Paint often needs to be thin to be used in a sprayer, so I thinned both the primer and the paint that I used about 10% with water. For example, I filled the mixing cup to 500 milliliters with paint and then added about 50 milliliters of water. I mixed the paint well and then poured it into the cup on the spray gun through a paint strainer to remove any debris that could potentially clog the spray gun. I then tested the sprayer on some scrap plywood and adjusted the settings to where I liked them, and then sprayed a coat of primer on the backside of every door, and when that had dried, a coat on the front of every door, being sure to get the primer onto the sides and into all the corners of the door. I'm moving around the door here, but in the future, I'd like to make some kind of swiveling paint station to make this a lot easier to do. I sprayed on the primer in long steady strokes, about 6 to 8 inches from the surface of the door, pulling the trigger before moving over the door and releasing the trigger after passing over the other end. I overlapped my strokes about halfway to ensure full coverage. After priming, I sanded the entire door with 320 grit sandpaper until it felt smooth to the touch and wiped off the dust with a tack cloth. So this may not seem that important, but it really is a critical step that lays the foundation for a nice top coat. I then sprayed on 2 coats of paint to the back of the doors and 3 on the front. I still have a lot to learn about how to achieve a smooth finish, as I had a slight orange peel texture on my doors, but even with my inexperience, it turned out way better than I could have done by hand painting, and I'm pretty happy with the results. If you have any tips for me on what I can do to get a better finish, I'd love to hear them down in the comments. I also cut some shelves to go on the shelf pins inside the cabinets, and I wanted to try a new method for painting the plywood edge that I mentioned earlier, so I used all-purpose joint compound meant for drywall, and I applied it generously to the edge I wanted to paint. This stuff sands super easily when dry, and it left a smooth edge. Here it is after painting, and I think that this could be a viable alternative to edge banding when painted, but I need to test it more and see how durable it is. Now that all the doors are painted, I need to attach the frosted glass to the small stack cabinet doors. I laid the glass in place and I positioned a small nylon washer an inch from the corner and marked its location. Then I center punched and pre-drilled the hole. I removed the remaining film from the polycarbonate and screwed the washer in place, making sure to hold the washer down against the glass. I found that four washers was sufficient to hold the glass in on the small doors, but more might be needed for larger doors. And with that, all the doors are done and we're ready to install the cabinets. I first made a few marks on the wall 18 inches above the counters below and then shined my laser level across those marks. I got some help to hold a scrap board up at that laser line and temporarily screwed it to the studs in the wall using cabinet screws and then shined a vertical laser line aligned with the edge of the cabinet below. I teleported the cabinet from the shop to the counter here and then lifted it up on top of the support board. I really recommend finding another person or perhaps a really talented dog to help hold the cabinet until it's attached to the wall. And you can't really see it, but I'm putting a screw through the top cabinet stretcher, but not all the way tight, just enough to keep that cabinet from falling while I adjust the positioning of it. I checked the cabinet in all directions with the level and then shimmed it where it needed, and once it was level, I screwed it into the wall studs through the lip on the bottom and through the cabinet stretchers. When the cabinets were firmly secured, I removed the support board underneath, and I'm happy to report that they did not fall down. To remove the parts of the shims that stick out, I scored them with a utility knife a few times and then snapped them off. There are gaps between the cabinet and the wall, so I filled them with a bead of caulk and smoothed it out using a wet finger. Where the gaps were large, I had to wait for the caulk to dry and then come back and do it a second time. At this point, the doors are ready to be installed. I screwed the cabinet hinges to the doors and then placed the door in position flush with the bottom of the cabinet and marked the midline of each door hinge. When I made the base cabinets for the kitchen, I made a template to offset the hinge holes the correct amount from the front edge, which is 37 millimeters for these particular hinges, and I used that template here to mark the hole locations, and then center punched, pre-drilled them, and screwed on the mounting plates. I set the hinges in place on the mounting plates and knocked each one until they locked together. And I used a plastic hammer for the rest of these, as some of them took a little bit of force the first time around. Repeat for the other door, and we're getting close. The stacked cabinet doors were sized so that there would be an 1/8 inch gap between them and the main cabinet doors below, so I placed a 1/8 inch tile spacer between the two, marked the hinge locations, and installed these doors just like the others. I added adhesive bumper pads at the corners of all the doors where they touch the cabinet to protect the paint. To install a cabinet pull, I made a mark at 4 inches up from the bottom of the door, and then placed the center of my cabinet hardware jig on that mark. Added a piece of scrap plywood to the back to prevent blowout and clamped it all in place. And I drilled out the holes for the cabinet pull and screwed the pull in place, first by hand and then with the screwdriver. I inserted 4 shelf pins for each adjustable height shelf and dropped the shelves in place. For crown molding, I'm going with a really simple design with a 1x6 up against the cabinets and walls and a 1x4 that butts up against that and is up on the ceiling. But you can definitely go with whatever crown molding you like best. And I'm not actually going to install my crown molding right now, as it's going to be a lot easier to figure out the measurements relative to the range hood cabinet between the two once that range hood cabinet is made and installed. All right, we are done making the cabinets and the kitchen is getting pretty close to done now, which I'm super excited about because I'm ready to not work on a kitchen anymore. All the tools and materials I use are linked down in the video description, as well as the free plans you can check out to help you make these. If you like the video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and let me know what you thought down in the comment section. If you're not already a subscriber, consider doing that. And if you want to see more projects like this one, check out my other videos. And if you want to see what I'm up to in between videos, find me on Instagram. Thanks for watching, and until next time, go build yourself and some cabinets. Can you say cabinets without a hiss? Cabinets. 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 It's not possible.